You're listening to In the Moment on South Dakota Public Broadcasting. I'm your host, Lori Walsh. Well, one of the most prestigious culinary awards in the country has taken notice of one Sioux Falls kitchen. Sanaa Aberesk is a finalist for Best Chef Midwest Award from the James Beard Foundation, and she returns to our studios. Thank you so much, Sanaa. Welcome.
Thank you for having me.
And congratulations.
Thank you very much.
I think the last time you were here, I said this, but it's worth saying again. I think I have been talking to you about this restaurant on the radio and in print for print publications for quite some time.
Yes.
You said you opened Sanaa's 20 years ago.
Yep. Yeah. And Thanksgiving would be 19
yes.
years.
And 19 years ago, Sioux Falls was not the same town from a culinary standpoint. You helped make it the town.
Thank you. I'd like to think so, yes. Thank you.
Did you know at the time?
No, actually. I mean, we were going to restaurant, and in my mind, I kept saying, I wish they have this. I wish they can do this. Then finally, so I knew there was a need for this kind of food. The way we do it. Anyway, then I took the leap and everybody thought I'm totally out of my mind. I proved them wrong. 19 years.
19 years and a finalist for James Beard.
Yes.
One of the things that was unique about what you were offering was that it was healthy.
It's healthy, made from scratch, using olive oil. We have no fryer. I think we are one of the few restaurants in the country that we literally have no fryer, no ketchup. We don't fry, and no chips, no French fries. And that's why people thought, this is South Dakota, you're not going to survive.
Right.
And, you know.
A lot of vegan options, a lot of vegetarian options, gluten-free options.
Gluten-free, yes. I mean, we do everything from scratch. When you do everything from scratch, it's easy to accommodate all allergies.
Yeah.
No peanuts, no peanut oil. So I take pride that when somebody walk in the restaurant and then my staff call me, they said she has allergies or he has allergies. And I say, okay, tell me what's your allergy. And he said, you can't feed me. I said, well, tell me. So then, he lists or she lists. I say, okay, we can fix this for them. And he said, you mean I can eat? I say, yeah, absolutely. You can eat.
You're training cooking school in Florence, Italy, Cordon Bleu in Paris, a nutrition degree.
From California, Cal State Pomona.
Yeah.
And agricultural engineering from Damascus University. So for me, I feel all these degrees are related. You know, as a farmer's daughter and as an agricultural engineer, I know what it takes to have this fresh produce for you, weather-wise, work-wise, everything. And then as a dietitian, I know what effect on your body. Mm. And then as a chef, I need to make it tasty enough that you're willing to enjoy it. So it's all a circle.
That's one whole aspect of Sanaa. And then there is this aspect of love and family and food and dancing in the face of hardship, like families who've been in war-torn countries, who've suffered in earthquakes, the recent death of your husband, grief, loss, and there you are in the kitchen putting your hands in the bowl and feeding us still. I'm going to get emotional, but there you are feeding us still through all of that in our lives and in yours.
Family overseas with the war, basically, I was their stone, They're having a hard time. They're still having a hard time. Whether it's earthquake, they still have aftershock, and the economy because of the sanction, the war. But then, when we talk to each other, I'm doing good, and they know they have their support. I'm there for them. I'm proud, not only me, my brother too, that we are doing everything we can to make them go through life. And I wouldn't say untouched, but surviving the circumstances. With COVID, I found, people were depressed, lonely. And so that's why I started dancing as a joke to make people laugh. And people responded. So that's why I kept it. Same with the vegetable on my face and everything. Some people, including my mom, she thought I'm crazy. But when I got an email or message, oh, you made me laugh, you made my day, I laughed so hard, it made my day.
Yeah.
You know, it gave me comfort. And then through my husband's sickness, he was my champion. So, and he would go to my table, to my restaurant, and he has his own table. So for me also, I felt like I'm honoring him. And he loved food. I mean, he loved food. So yeah. For me, it's like, this is all, it's all part of giving and taking back, because it's making me feel comfortable, you know, and happy and alive.
Yeah. Yeah. For people who haven't been here, and I guess we should say former U.S. Senator Jim Abaresk is Sanaa's husband who recently died. You walk into Sanaa's, you are greeted with the smells, the beautiful smells. Many, I know for me, growing up here in the Midwest, I had never smelled these smells before. So they were new.
Yes.
And interesting. There's color, there's art, and then there's a table right up front that's big and round and says reserved.
Yep.
And that was for?
He actually bought the table.
Did he? Is that, yeah.
Because when he first started coming with his friends, you know, they kept moving my small tables, and the noise just drove me nuts. So I said, Jim, stop moving the tables. He said, well, we want to sit together. Yeah. I don't know. And he called it the thinking table, or, you know, it doesn't matter what your political view. As long as you have a, you can defend it, you're welcome to sit on that table. So everybody was welcome.
Yeah.
And finally he said, well, what about if I bought my own tree, own table? I said, okay, go ahead. So he bought the table. So that's his table. He bought that table for him.
You've cooked against Bobby Flay. You've had national attention before. What does the James Beard Award as a finalist mean to you in this culinary journey that you have?
Well, the James Beard Award is almost like the Oscars.
Yeah.
For, you know, for us as a chef, the James Beard Oscars is for actors. So you can be so good, but when you are a character recognized by your own fellow,
yeah,
it's like an extra, how to say it? I don't want to say it. It's more than a compliment. It's more, you know, give you street grit between
sure.
your fellow
yeah.
chef. Between your customers, they know, okay, you know, you have the best role ever, the best food ever, but now you're recognized by the James Beard. So it's like pat on your back, like what you're doing is good. Keep doing it.
I am biased in this, but I think that the Midwesterners that come out for this award are more influential than a California chef or a New York chef or a Philadelphia chef. Because of the expectation in the broader nation that we're a place that grows food,
mm-hmm. yes.
but that doesn't necessarily innovate, reinvent, or rethink how it is prepared and served. And so it always makes
right.
me feel...
You're absolutely right, yes. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we have, I mean, the chefs in Midwest, first of all, we've been ignored for a long time. You know, they call it the flyover, zone.
Yeah.
I mean, Jim gave me an article 4 years ago. It was in New York Times magazine that the guy was traveling to try food to different states. And he said then when he got to Minnesota, he decided to stop because he won't find anything in the Midwest. And I said, you know,
yeah.
And Jim intentionally gave it to me because he knew it would make me really angry. So we have this against us. Another thing is that also we have short growing season. And, you know, we want to make the best of what we have. And then you are more challenged. You know, go to New York, you have one restaurant after the other, after the other, after the other, after the other. Ethnic food, different ethnicity from all over the world. But in the Midwest, you are more challenged to convince people to come and eat falafel, to come and eat tabbouleh.
Yeah.
What's muhammara? You know, something they never experienced before. And you have to make it so good that they're willing to come back again. And that's the key to your survival.
That's communication, too.
Absolutely.
For you. I mean, having been to your restaurant many times, that's you don't ever feel intimidated or excluded. You can literally go out to anyone there, but often it's you. Often you will come out and say, well, what is it that you like? I will give you something that you can eat,
mm-hmm.
and I will give you something that you like.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's for me was crucial when I opened my restaurant. I want people to feel they're coming home.
Mm.
Literally, they're coming to their mom and pop. Because whenever I went to my mom, you know, my family's home, food was always in the center. My mom has always something on the counter. So you, in Nepal, while you're talking to her, then we're cooking together, we eat together. We had friends who walk in immediately, whether my mom knows they're hungry or not, she'll put some food, you know. Oh, you're traveling. Come on, you have to eat something, you know, all this. Oh, you're not hungry? Take it with you, you know. So I wanted to have it at home. I don't want it to be intimidating. So I can easily make it so fancy plating and charge you $50. But I didn't want to do that. I want them to feel like they're coming home, they're eating ingredient. It could be weird, but they're so at ease to eating it. And they're not shy about asking me, you know, so what's in it? I like it, but what's in it? You know, they don't feel like you're looking down on them because they didn't recognize what's harissa or what's, you know.
Sure. Or you go back the next week and you say, I want that thing that you gave me last week, but I still can't pronounce it.
Yes.
And you'll just help us out.
Yes.
Which has made you a leader in a community.
Thank you.
Culturally as well as from a culinary standpoint. You have taught us not only how to eat, but how to treat one another.
Thank you. I mean, the community here, honestly, I think it was just an accident that, you know, after I said I do to Jim, he went to move to South Dakota. And I'm glad we did. At the beginning, I was nervous. But I stayed in Washington, D.C. Probably I'd be working a job at a hospital or, you know, somewhere as a dietitian. I'm so glad we moved here and gave me the courage to open. And people welcomed me. So I think it's, and I had my baby here.
Yeah.
So any way you look at it, as if it's my family, honestly.
Yeah.
And even my daughter, after the return from the James Beard Foundation, my husband's passing, she said, Mom, I don't think you can move anywhere else. You have to retire here because of all the love you get.
I think, I don't know if you know this or not, but you do a fair amount of, people take things out and, you know, catering or, you know, we'll bring it. There's a graduation and and people say, you know, what are we having? Oh, it's Sanaa's. You know, it's your name.
Thank you.
And everybody feels like you personally cooked it in the kitchen in which we're at, even though it's somebody's house on the other side of town. That's how powerful.
But that's what makes me feel so good.
Yeah. Some people would call that a brand, but I would just call it your name. It's an identity.
It is. And that's why we have it on the
T-shirt.
On the T-shirt. And on our food labels. I still, after 19 years, I'm the one who cook everything. I have my staff, they prep for me, they make the dough, but I'm the one who still cook because I love it.
Yeah.
You know, I love being in the kitchen cooking. I mean, that's my meditation.
Yeah.
Even at home. I go home now and there's nobody to cook for. I still cook.
Still cook. And you want us to cook too. That's
absolutely
the other thing.
You want
people to have that sort of same experience with their kitchen.
Absolutely.
Even if it's a very simple, like I'm never going to be a cook like you are.
Yeah, but you know, you don't have to make a fancy dish. Make
a
simple pasta dish. It gives you such a reward for yourself and your family. And honestly, like I said, when you start, you come to feel like almost like a warmth going through your body.
Yeah. You taught me that 20 years ago when I interviewed you, like love being in your kitchen. I think that was one of the things was like, create a kitchen space that you love. It was about joy,
yes,
and it was about love.
Mm-hmm.
And again, ahead of your time, but awfully glad that we're catching up with you. Well, congratulations on being a finalist.
Thank
the
you.
James Beard Restaurant and Chef Awards Ceremony, June 5th in Chicago.
In Chicago.
Yeah.
I have my room. I reserved my room, and this weekend I'm reserving my airline, so I'm set.
They better pay attention. That's
yes,
what
ma'am.
We have to say.
Yes, ma'am.
Sanaa Everest, thank you for stopping by.
Thank you.